Right, so let's look at the basics of the RSA method. With RSA, what we have is Bob and Alice. So here we have Bob, and over here we have Alice. So Bob has a public key and a private key. So here is his private key. And here is Alice's private key. They then both have a public key. Now what happens is that we can use the public and the private key together. So if Bob encrypts something with Alice's public key, then Alice will decrypt with her private key. Okay, and that's the way that the encryption process works. We can also use RSA to sign for a message. In this case, we might take the message and a hash and then use Bob's private key to sign the hash or encrypt the hash. When Alice receives that, she will also take a hash of the message, and then she'll be able to decrypt with the hash with Bob's public key. This will then give the result of the same hash as she has computed for the message. In this way, we can prove it was Bob who signed the message, and also that it hasn't been changed. Okay, so let's look at the basics of RSA. So with RSA, we use an exponential cipher. So we take a message and we have an encryption key and a modulus. And in this way, we create the cipher. To recover the message, we basically take the cipher and find our decryption key, and then that gives us the message back. Our public key is then E, N, the modulus, and D, N is the decryption key or the private key. Okay, so let's look at how RSA really works in practice. The first thing that we do is that we create the modulus by taking two large prime numbers and multiplying them together. This is a computationally difficult problem if these are large prime numbers. So we make sure these are large enough, such as taking two 512-bit prime numbers and making 1000-bit modulus. These days we typically use 2k or even 4k, so our prime numbers themselves are probably 1000 or 2000 bits long. The longer these prime numbers, the more secure our message will be. Okay, so once we have this, we now calculate a value of phi. And phi is equal to p minus 1 times q minus 1. Then what we need to do is to make sure that e, the encryption key value, does not share a factor with phi. So we select that, and then once we have that, we need to determine the value of D to make sure that this will work. If we can make this to work, then we have created a trapdoor that allows these two functions to work. This is known as the inverse mod of D. Inverse D mod N. Okay, and we can easily compute that. It's basically D to the minus 1 mod N is the value that we actually compute. So let's take a practical example and see how we can get this to work. Okay, so let's take a value of P equal to 3 and Q equal to 11. So those are our two prime numbers. We'll then calculate the modulus as 3 times 11, which is 33. First thing we'll then do is calculate our phi value. So it's P minus 1, which is 2, times Q minus 1, which is 10. So that will be 2 times 10, which is 20. Now we must make sure that there is no common factor between 33 and 22. It's often known as a GCD, or greatest common denominator, of this value and this value is equal to 1. But we'll do it manually. So the factors in here are 2, obviously 4, 5, and so on. So let's pick a value of 3, because 3 is not a factor of phi. Next, we must make D times E mod of phi equal 1. And we could do an inverse mod of D, inverse of D mod 20, to find that value easily, but we can actually see quite quickly that if the value of D is 7, and 7 times 3 is 21, mod 20 gives us 1. So the value of D is equal to 7. So if we now try to cipher this, then if we take a message of 4, then our cipher becomes 4 to the power of 3, mod of 33, and I think when we compute that we get a value of 31. Then when we want to recover the message or decrypt it, we'll take 31, we'll raise it to the power of 7, mod 33, and magically we get the value of 4 back again. Okay, so this gives a quick overview of RSA encryption.